Eta saiatuko gara alde neurrian behintzat zuek egindako galderak islariei helarazten. Os recuerdo que a través de esta aplicación vamos a seguir conversando. Ah. Es la manera de ir construyendo conversación cuando necesariamente tenemos que tener tiempos y lugares un poco diferentes. También es verdad que tendremos un momento de comida para aprovechar también para trabajar, que es lo que solemos hacer incluso cuando es la hora de la comida. Askotariko galderak daude, denetarikoak, uste dut, bueno, jaso bezala, itzulpen zerbitzuarekin moldatzeko moduan izango garela. Por cierto, esan digute asko gustatu izan zaiela euskerari leku garrantzia eman izana ekitaldi honetan eta gai honetan, eta eskertzen dugu komentari hori egin duen partaidea. Emakume gutxi daudela esaten ari dira. Ainhoa, eta zuri esan behar dizut, nik zuri emakume gutxi daudela esan aipatu da, esan da, hor talentuaren borroka honetan hor badaukagula lan bat garrantzitsua egin beharra pertsona batzuen izenak eta aipatu dituzte eta esaten zuten antolatzailei kontuan izan hau. Esan behar dizut.
Bai, bai, ezin dizut kontrakorik esan, ez? Neri askotan gertatzen zait, tamalez, horrelako argazkitan egotea. Txaketa gorria gazten dut horrelakotan, ondo ikusteko, emakumeak ere badaudela. Eta gogoratzen dut, Exxon kide izan ginean, Finlandian izan genuen lehenengo workshopean, berdina gertatu zitzaian, emakume bakarran itzan. Eta egia da, eta lehen aipatu dugu, bai formakuntzan, bai unibertsitate mailan, ehuneko 50 hori falta zaiula, ez? Eta benetan garrantzitsua da, horiek ere gure sistema guztietan, gure industrian, eta gure apostu estrategiko guztietan sartzea. Eta, esan beharra daukat, aukeratuta genituela bi emakume, aukeratuta, hau da, beste guzti batzuen artean bi aukeratu genituen, Infibetik Elena García zetorren, baina azken momentuan ezin izan du etorri, eta European Security Networketik Maria Krotofil zetorren, baina orain dela bi egun abisatu zigun ezin zula etorri. Beraz, bi bat zeuden, tamal ezin izan dut etorri, baina hurren gorako kontatuko ditugu.
Hori ere kontatzen nahi nuen, zepen handia izan dugu oso izlari onak ere badirelako, eta edo zein kasutan, eta orain bai datorren berriro arira. Aipatu da, zibersegurtasunaren isla handi eta argi bat dagoela hemen, Gipuzkoako talentuaren isla handi bat dagoela hemen, eta galdetu egiten digute, nolako harremana edo zer emango duen ziurrek hori erakustarazteko, momentu honetan hemen zibersegurtasun industrialaren inguruan diharduten enpresak, baino talentu hori erakustarazteko gizarteari ziurre guneak zer egingo duen galdetzen zaitu.
Bai, nik uste dut, ziurrek bi helburu nagusi ditula, ez? Alde batetik esan dugun bezala, gure industria indartu, ziberatake, zibererasoien aurrean, eta bestetik, nik esango nuke berrikuntza eta espezializazio arlo hori zibersegurtasunean areagotzea, ez? Eta bi helburu horietan gure zibersegurtasun enpresak behar beharrezkoa dira eta nik esango nuke aktore printzipala direla, ez? Aktore nagusiak direla. Eta ziurrek hori egingo du, enpresa industrialak harremanetan kontaktuan jarriko ditugu zibersegurtasun enpresa horiekin, berrikuntza proiektua bultzatzeko, esan dugun bezala azpiegitura oso teknologikoa jarriko ditugu beraien eskutan esperimentazio eta proba desberdinak egiteko, nazioarte mailako proiektua jarriko diegu elkarlanean, eta hori dena talentukin egin behar da, ez? Nik uste beraz, gure zibersegurtasun enpresak, eta argitu nahiko nuke, guk orain arte lanen egin dugu, nitxo deitzen digunak, ez, zibersegurtasun enpresa, baina nitxokoak, askoz gehiago daude, eta Gipuzkoan askoz gehiago ditugu, eta hori ere proiektu hauekin, elkarlan lan horrekin, denak bildu nahi ditugu, zentru ireki bada noski, eta denekin lan egin nahi dugu. Beraz, behar beharrezkoa talentua, eta talentu hori aprobetsatu dugu, etorkizuneko postu estrategiko hauetan, batez ere aurrera egiteko.
We have some other questions, some of them for John, Luigi, Benjamin too. And first of all, for John Lyons, Some people is asking about more than a question, is perhaps they are looking for your opinion about the real commitment of the European institutions in order to support or to boast an structure and a strategy to develop cybersecurity strategies in the different countries. And they ask about, if, in your opinion, is there a real commitment in this field?
I've run out of ears. I missed the first part of the question.
More than a question, people, I think it's more than a clear question. Is your opinion about the commitment of the European institutions at the different countries, in your opinion, if they are really in the same page, if they are singing for the same page?
Okay, thank you. Well, I can say from first-hand knowledge, for many years I've been working with the Council of Europe, mm-hmm. Particularly on cybercrime and supporting the spread of the Budapest Convention to many countries outside of Europe, and with various departments in the Commission. We were very happy to be involved in the setup of the European Cybercrime Centre at Europol. And I have noticed over these last 4 or 5 years a real growth in the commitment within the Commission and the other institutions to be leaders in cybersecurity, to help the 27, 28 member states to implement the best cybersecurity strategies that are available. So I'm really encouraged by the effort, by the investment that European institutions are making in order to help the security of the entire EU family. I have to say that some of the member states are quite far behind and will need more help than others in this journey, but I'm really encouraged, and I believe that they have the best interests of those member states in investing in the future of cybersecurity.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. About European policies and, you know, more than that, focused on the state or state of the art in terms of research and innovation and development in Europe, comparing with some other parts. And this is a question for you, Luigi, because they say, according to your knowledge of the state of art in relation to cybersecurity, what does Europe need? And in a more concrete way, perhaps comparing with Israel, and maybe Benjamin could add some other point of views.
Well,
what do we need?
This is a question that would need full conference. You know? to simplify, I would start from investment. Investment, because Europe, both as Europe and as national or local level, we still have a very low level of investment. And mentioned before, at best in the future, we will have something like 500, 600 million of euro per year, 2021, this is my estimation. Today is still much less, and when you compare with what is invested in the States and other big countries, investments are much higher. You don't need to have only public sector investment. For instance, in Israel, you have this already for many years, this national, I think it's innovation, it's translation, is innovation fund, which is really pushing all, which is supporting the development of startups and innovation in general. And this is led by the government, actually. So it's a national, but this is thanks to the understanding of the politician of the need for such investment fund, and also for the better understanding of the need for the economic sector. Mm-hmm. And this is what is missing. Well, coming back maybe to the question that you said you asked to John, he was very positive. I would be a little bit more negative, just to challenge him. We started yesterday evening. a bit more negative in the sense that the Commission is just understanding, starting to understand what cybersecurity is, what the European single digital market is, and what are the needs. And on top of that, the Commission and the Parliament have a strong constraint, because on one end, they want to build up something in common. At the same time, when it comes to security, they have to deal, as I said before, with the sovereignty of the different countries, which are limiting the dialogue, which are limiting the exchange of information, which are somehow limiting the cooperation. And it's a matter of maturity, but also the different sectors, they have problems to talk each other, to cooperate with each other, as I said also in the example I gave before on certification. So all this needs a certain time to build the understanding. So what I want to say is the Commission really needs to understand, and is still lacking, the real, what the industry wants, what the industry needs in cybersecurity. So they have a vision from Brussels, and when you come to the reality like here in a region, and you understand what are the needs, you see that there's still a mismatch. Mm-hmm. So the strategy, nice politically correct strategy that you build up in Brussels, is not really what the very basic sometimes requests which are coming from industry in the field. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Benjamin, do you agree with this?
Yes. To a large extent. Can you hear me? Yeah. I would speak up. Yes, to a large extent, I agree with all was said. There is a lot of very interesting studies that try to understand what makes an innovation cluster successful. There are many attempts around the world. In Europe, it's been 10, maybe 15 years that we are trying to replicate a Silicon Valley model and been unsuccessful, to be honest, with some exception. And the role of the military is often very well documented in helping successful innovation cluster grow. It has always had a very important role, whether you are talking about cybersecurity or other domains of innovation. Military definitely always had its role, both in America, in Israel, and in other places, as the availability of venture capital, as the entrepreneurial mindset. I think another and government role that you mentioned is very important, but I think something that has been critical and differentiating for specifically the case of Israel and its success story was the fact that actually you had a lot of corporate R&D, a lot of leading corporate centers coming there to do R&D exclusively. And that, I think, has helped a journey where you have basically a very small country facing gigantic threats, and everybody knows about it. So that means that essentially you have swathes of population that are very early on in their life sensitized to the problems in cyber, to technology, and at university, the army receive a training that is equivalent to a university degree. But then typically the journey goes with a first step in your career at an R&D center of a leading multinational corporate. You are part of this and you start understanding the applied problems that you were talking about. When you go work for the R&D center of ABB, of Siemens, of Citibank, you start having the real world knowledge of what a trader in London is struggling with, of what industrial production line is really concerned about, and then you move out and create a startup. And that combination, I think, of mindset, venture capital availability, government support, but also sometimes need to create their people more awareness, matched with the role of multinational R&D center, then that's a secret sauce. I think that's hard to replicate, but that's proven to be quite successful.
Perhaps harder to replicate, and that's another question straight to you, because they are talking about, and yes, John, I'll give you the chance. Some people is asking about what do we need to do in Gipuzkoa, considering the size of the territory, considering the companies we've got, to create this startup ecosystem in cybersecurity. But in your opinion, do we need?
It's a good question, and I'd love to collaborate more. We're talking a little bit about it. I think, Israelis have failed when they tried to replicate what America was strong in. It goes back to the theory of competitive advantage, I suppose. trying to do exactly what others are hyper successful at maybe is not always the best strategy. I think there is a huge role though for better partnership. On one side of the equation you have a country that sometimes feels a little bit isolated and far from everything, far from their customers, far from exactly the understanding of what they need. And on the other side, you have ecosystems such as these that are prioritizing in a very clear and ambitious way cybersecurity. Rather than creating a small Basque country version of Israel, why not increasing the links between the region? We are seeing some effective programs with Germany, with Italy, with many regions around the world, where it is really about aggregating by industries or by sub-industries a series of problems and then creating innovation jams, creating accelerators, creating innovation roadshow, where we bring the best of the innovation from there into here so that it solves the problems today, rather than trying to fuss. It's very hard to build an innovation ecosystem, and you have a lot of documents on how unsuccessful the countries have been around the world in doing that.
Thank you. And John.
By the way, sorry, that's exactly what we are doing in EXO, or linking the region.
Sorry.
Yeah. Don't hesitate to interrupt me, of course, and interrupt yourselves.
No, if I may, I'd like to add to the other side of the coin. And I fully support what Benjamin is saying about innovation and not one size fits all. But I have the thing that about getting back to the basics for businesses in Kaputskwa that I think is worth just re-emphasizing, okay? Because whilst we're building up the innovation and skills and attracting ladies into the profession, the businesses that are operating here and now have got issues that need to be fixed immediately. Okay, so I'm not saying, you know, none of that is poor. We should be doing that. But in parallel, and at the same time, there are some very basic steps that every company in Kaputskwa could take to make themselves more secure immediately. Mm-hmm. Very simple, straightforward, mm-hmm. technical security controls. Well, we'll have a list of them at the center, which, you know, our job will be to share with you, and by supporting our technical security companies, they can help with a small amount of consultancy and work. So it's a bit like home. If you imagine, how many times have I been asked, if you know anything about computers, your aunt or your grandmother or your mother says, John, how do I secure this new laptop I've bought? Well, you know, keep your operating system up to date. Keep your antivirus and security suite up to date, and don't click on links from people you don't know, okay? So those are the basics for home, if you like. And there are some very simple things that every business can do, which are not expensive, can be done immediately, and will mitigate up to 80% of common online threats, okay? They won't help you fight the Chinese, but they will help you fight the digital cyber carpet bombing that we're seeing every day, okay? So I'd like us to start with the basics also. Thank you.
Interesting to see that people is commenting, you know, I do it, for example, they are commenting on your comments, and they are just adding those other points of view, so it's very interesting to see that we are really talking to each other. Alex, behin eta berriro, aipatzen da, galderatan, betiko harreman sartze horretan, sektore publikoa, sektore pribatua, hemen nolabait ordezkatzen ari gara bi mundu horiek, bi mundutez hitz egitea posible baldin bada. Nola artikulatu behar dira harremanak, hori da egiten zaizun galdera? Sinergiak, koordinazioa, enpresa erakundeak, baina baita ere erakundeen artean horreipatu da ere, zure momentuan ere, zure aurkezpenean ere aipatu duzun zentruaren eta ziurren arteko sinergia, koordinazioa, horren inguruan gaiak eta azaldu dira hemen, besteak beste esaten da, bueno, mina honegindako apustu horretaz ere galdetzen zaizu.
Bai, a ver, elkarlan publiko-pribatuak, kolazion publiko-pribatua deitzen jakona, a ver, ba, oso garrantzitsua da. Berez oso arreza da, berez entitate, bueno, entita publikoa ordezkatzen duten aldetik argi da, lehenengo herri mailan edo gobernu mailan argi auki behitzuzula zentsu dian helburuak, eta berez oso simplia da, berez da, bueno, ni enpresa pribatutik nator, eta nik bagi zepetatzen enpresa entzun. Behin helburuak argi itxuzunean, enpresa pribatuari entzun, zebia da, bueno, enpresa pribatu, zentor teknologia entzun. Eta behin informazio hori jasota, azkenian proiektu bat lantzea da. Eta adibide asko ditugu gobernu aldetik, bai gobernu eta enpresa pribatu aldetik, edo bai gobernu eta beste entitate publikoekin, diputazioekin adibidez, ba egin izan ditugunak. Erreza da eta batzutan zaiera berian elkarkidetza kolaborazioa, baina hori da giltza, Benjaminek be ontzen bertan esan da, Euskadi Terlen arteko basubi hoizek sortziana, hori da besterik ez, entzun beste aldiak zen nahi dabe, gobernu aldetik argedakau gu enpresa pribatuei zerbitzu emoteko gaudela, beraz, berai entzun eta hortik aurrera erramintak sortu.
Eta bidea elkarrekin egiteko moduak egin. Alejandro, nos dicen, considerando que cómo son, en una gran mayoría, las empresas guipuzcoanas, que son pequeñas y medianas empresas, pymes, sabemos que también son los agentes a los que más les cuesta entrar en ciertas dinámicas. Y nos preguntan qué es lo que, bajo tu criterio, debería plantearse una pyme de forma inmediata. Si hubiese estado aquí, después de haber escuchado lo que he escuchado hasta ahora, ¿qué crees, qué recomendación le harías a una pyme? ¿Qué crees que es lo que debería plantearse de forma inmediata?
Bueno, ¿se me escucha, por cierto?
Sí. ¿Sí?
Una pyme, pues hay que pensar que no tiene los medios, ¿vale?, que suelen tener las grandes compañías, no suele tener un equipo de seguridad detrás, ¿vale? Entonces, pues, lógicamente tiene que iniciar una labor de concienciación, tiene que saber en qué punto está, ¿vale?, a nivel de ciberseguridad, tiene que conocerse, tiene que saber cómo está en ese punto. Y, bueno, como se ha dicho anteriormente, hay una serie de cuestiones básicas, de buenas prácticas, ¿vale?, que deberían tomarse en consideración y que son principios muy, muy sencillitos, ¿vale?, que una pyme o una empresa, una micropyme, pymes, etcétera, deberían de ejecutar. Y, bueno, en principio son esas cuestiones básicas, esas buenas prácticas, las que te marcan la diferencia al final, ¿vale? Hablando de seguridad digital, hablando de ciberseguridad. Y, bueno, ya si tiene el gran problema en ocasiones es esos medios económicos para invertir en formación de sus empleados o para obtener empleados con skills, con habilidades técnicas, ¿vale? Entonces, bueno, siempre que sea posible hay que dimensionar adecuadamente, obviamente, el capital, pero hay que tener o tomar más en serio, más en consideración la ciberseguridad, como estamos viendo últimamente, ¿no? O sea, en los últimos tiempos hemos visto cómo ciertas compañías, quizá no en el ámbito de las pymes, ¿vale?, pero bueno, nosotros, por ejemplo, hemos recibido en la parte de incidentes auténticas ruegos de, por favor, descifradme el disco duro, ¿vale?, después de un ataque de ransomware, porque tengo todas las nóminas de los trabajadores, todas las documentaciones o documentos importantes de mi compañía cifrados y no puedo seguir trabajando, ¿vale? Entonces es realmente, dentro de las posibilidades de las pymes, pues tienen que empezar a tomar esas medidas básicas y, si se lo pueden permitir, pues por supuesto, invertir un poquito más.
Os preguntaban también, y lo someto también a que intervengáis como os parezca más oportuno. Creo que os van traduciendo, ¿verdad?, e interpretando a los diferentes idiomas. Porque también nos dicen, bueno, ¿qué diríamos al CEO de una pequeña, mediana empresa? Ya hoy mismo, una entrevista hoy a la tarde, para decirle, no pienses en gasto en ciberseguridad, sino que piensa en inversión en ciberseguridad. ¿Qué argumento le daríais para ayudar a que cambie este punto de vista?
¿Cualquiera?
Cualquiera. Uh-huh.
Bueno, el argumento, al CEO lo que me lo va a doler es la cuenta resultados, como a todo. Pues si lo linkas a un posible beneficio. De todas formas, la ciberseguridad, yo creo que no hay que verla simplemente como defensa. Yo creo que hemos estado hablando, lo ha comentado la diputada y otros también, la ciberseguridad también puede ser un valor competitivo de tu empresa, que dé valor a tu producto, a tu servicio. Y lo que hay que hacerle ver eso. Al final, queramos o no, la cuenta de resultados tira mucho. Es la que más tira, casi siempre, y todo lo que lo unamos ahí, primero por una posible parada de una fábrica, por ejemplo, y luego también porque va a tener un producto de valor añadido que va a poder vender mejor. Yo desde luego tendría, claro, yo me pongo en el papel del CEO y me gustaría que me dijeran eso, desde luego.
Yes. I think if I understood correctly, because I'm trying to guess what exactly you're saying, but you're saying what will encourage the adoption of more security practice on an ongoing basis rather than. So I think the disappointing answer is that people won't have a chance to choose whether to adopt more security in the future. We are seeing a clear trend from the regulators to impose measures to adopt security in everything that a company does. GDPR is an excellent example of that. It's the most radical revision of data protection law in the last 20 years. And it imposes on every company that holds EU citizen data, which is about every company in their CRM, in their financial system, in their every company of even small size holds EU personal data. The GDPR says if you do hold that, you will have to build security by design and by default in every product and in every process that you have as a company. And if you don't, you will have fines up to 4% of your revenue. And so, and there are other examples than GDPR, that there are drives, for example, to better understand the security risk of all your third-party suppliers. Now, if you're a logistical supply company, your whole business is depending on that. And your clients will have imposition from regulators more and more around the world, it's converging, that are saying basically to the board of directors, it's your responsibility to understand if your supplier is cyber resilient or not. And so, yes, of course, competitive advantage, there are the tier three, you know, forward-looking thinking type of customers who are proactive, but I think the good news, actually, is that companies will have to comply to a much more cyber-secure world in this area of, you know, in the developed nation, and then the rest of the world hopefully will follow.
And to the CEO, I would say, bring your accountant along, right? Your financial director, and I would say, look at the amount of money you're spending on ICT, information technology products. Smartphones through to servers through to cloud services, and if you're not dedicating at least 20% of that cost to securing it, then you're not spending enough. And to give them some measure of what to budget for, and then we can sit down and talk about how to spend that wisely.
20%, okay, right. Ainhoa, zuretzako beste galdera bat, hemen esaten zaiguna da, Foru Aldundiak erakunde publikoak dira eta erakunde bereziak zentzu zehatz baten, guk aldundiak zergak biltzen ditu. Bai? Eta zerga hoiei esker, halako antolaketa propio bat egin dezake. Eta regulazio gaitasun hori ere beste zenbait erakundeek ez daukatena badaukate. Hori abantaila izan daiteke enpresak, industria, bide honetan aurrera egin dezaten pizkarriak edo bestelakoak eskintzeko?
Bai, nik uste dut baietz. Gipuzkoako Foru Aldundiak bi erronka ditu, ez? Bi erronka nagusi beste batzuen artean, ez? Nagusi izango nuke alde batetik gure industriaren lehiakortasuna bultzatzea eta gure gizartearen ongi izatea bermatzea. Nik uste dut gure politika fiskala bi helburu nagusi horiek bideratzeko diseinatzen degula. Eta gure politika fiskala, gure promozio ekonomiko, gure sustapen ekonomiko politikarekin bat dator. Batez ere enpresa txiki eta ertainak bultzatzea, enpresetan langileen parte hartzailetza bultzatzea, ekintzailetasuna bultzatzea, talentua, Eta arlo guzti horiek dituzte bai dedukzio eta incentibo fiskalak. Atzo bertan onartu genuen batzar nagusietan azkeneko norma fiskala arlo horiek bultzatzeko, dedukzio eta incentiboak. Eta nik uste dut urrengo pausua apostu estrategikotan etorkizuneko sektore horiek definitzea dela. Zibersegurtasuna sektore horietan daukagu, etorkizuneko eta sektore estrategikoetan, eta horietan aktibidad prioritaria deitzen dana, mezenazgo figuratan ere aldundiak badauka bere eskumena, deduzioak eta egiteko, eta hori hala onartuta daukagu. Beraz, tresna oso garrantzitsua daukagu, arlo guzti horiek bultzatzeko.
En la conversación que está ocurriendo a través de las redes sociales, también algunas preguntas directas, una pregunta directa en concreto, nos dicen, ¿y por qué voy a contratar los servicios de una empresa que ofrece sus servicios de ciberseguridad cuando puedo acudir pues, a Incibe o puedo acudir a cualquiera de los centros? Una pregunta concreta que nos hacen, la lanzo para que bueno, los centros sí, o Incibe podáis
por alusiones,
luego, si queréis. Por alusiones como la tele.
La idea de los servicios ofrecidos desde Incibe es estar alineado o no solo aparse, mejor dicho, con servicios ofrecidos por compañías privadas. Y ya no solo alinearse, sino fomentar la demanda de esos servicios a través de canalizarla a través de empresas privadas. Vale, entonces, esa es un poquito la idea. Siempre se intenta todo lo que se ofrece pues que no solape, ¿vale? O no ofrecer el nivel que te ofrece, obviamente, una auditoría que te pueda hacer una empresa privada, ¿no? Entonces, se ofrecen herramientas a los ciudadanos, por ejemplo, ¿vale? que no puedes obtener de otra manera, pero a las empresas pues, se ofrecen ciertas herramientas de concienciación, ciertas herramientas de formación que, bueno, que hará que consuman o que conozcan mejor su ciberseguridad y sepan que pueden obtener más ciberseguridad contratando servicios de otras compañías, ¿no? O sea, la idea es alinearse y dar esa información de, oye, pues puedes ser más ciberseguro con estos servicios que te ofrecen todas estas compañías, ¿no?
Yo, Pilar, sí me gustaría decir que al que ha hecho la pregunta, no hay ni un servicio que demos nosotros que esté compitiendo absolutamente ninguno con la parte privada y quiero explicar, además ya lo he hecho en la presentación. Primero, dos cosas. Primero, hay cierto nivel de competencias a los que, en el caso desde el Advisory Security Center, no vamos a entrar y, de hecho, vamos a fomentar que sea la parte privada la que dé y, de hecho, bueno, pues en un futuro también habrá que posiblemente homologar empresas de la parte privada de ciberseguridad para que trabajen con nosotros, pero incluso esa persona que cree que el servicio se lo está dando el Advisory Security Center, que sepa que atrás está subcontratada una empresa privada. O sea, que no es el Cyber Security Center. El Cyber Security Center puede estar dándote un servicio, pero tenemos hecha una licitación o una compra o un pedido a una empresa privada. O sea, que es la empresa privada la que está dándote ese servicio y nunca la parte pública. De hecho, si no podríamos dimensionar el Cyber Security Center, pues podríamos meter 50 o 60 personas si quisiéramos dar ese servicio, pero no es así. O sea que no hay ningún servicio en el que estemos compitiendo con la empresa privada y si hubiera un problema, lo solucionaremos, nada, ningún problema.
Yo creo que las tres instituciones lo hemos dicho claramente, ¿no? No, el espíritu no es competir con la oferta privada, sino colaborar. Y de hecho los estudios, la monitorización, las investigaciones que hemos llevado a cabo la hemos hecho en colaboración con nuestras empresas. Por tanto, yo creo que nosotros desde luego lo tenemos muy claro.
Another question in this case, Benjamin, is for you. What do you think have been the most innovative initiatives in cybersecurity in the last, let's say, 2 years? You mentioned this, the middle ages, and that we are moving very slowly through the new era. In the 2 years, perhaps, yes.
The most innovative cybersecurity solutions or attacks?
The question says both. Solutions, both. But I would like to add also attacks.
So because of the always evolving threat landscape, sophistication of the threats, explosion of threats, you know, there are statistics that say every week you have 1 million new malwares. Sometimes it's mutation of existing malware. You take a malware, the code of the malware, you switch some lines of the code, and it's a mutation. It's the same family, but slightly different. Still manages to bypass all your protection. And then there are what we call APTs, like very sophisticated malwares, also an explosion of it. The increasing complexity of this threat landscape has meant that you have had, over the last 10 years, very big, very significant amount of entrepreneurs seeing an opportunity and saying, okay, to this threat, I will propose this solution. To this threat, I will propose this solution. And the result of this in the corporate market, in the enterprise environment, is that it has created a lot of complexity. In there are again good statistics around how many cybersecurity products the average enterprise is utilizing, and this is about 20 to 30. Sometimes it goes, you know, it grows in complexity with the size as well. 50 security products in many enterprises, all of them not build to talk to each other in the case of an incident. And so for me, overall, the you know, innovation belongs to hackers, unfortunately, and very, very sophisticated hackers. Now, you have to get away from that mentality of a hacker is just a bad boy with his you know, a hoodie in a dark corridor in some university. These are nation states, well-equipped with a lot of budget from these nations to do major attacks on infrastructure, on entire hospitals, on entire, it is really an increasing sophistication, and that's the innovation. The nation state attackers, such as China, such as Russia, such as Iran, are the big innovators in cybersecurity. On the solution side, though, because we have reacted in, and created such a fragmented environment, for me, one of the most interesting solution innovation is around what we call SOC automation and orchestration. SOC is a security operations center where all these security products are being managed. Mm-hmm. There is a lot of fatigue from the people who work in these environments. If we have some of them here, maybe you recognize yourself in that. They have to react constantly to false positive, to an attack, and when there is an attack, make sure that they write Python code so that the attack that infected one product is not going to go into the other product. Very manual, very reactive, very terrible job. And one of the good innovation there has been really artificial intelligence solution that connect, that creates the sort of connecting tissue between all the different security products that an enterprise has, so that when there is an attack in, let's say, your mobile phone because you've responded to downloaded the wrong document, it doesn't infect your network. It does it in an automatic way. It helps the security analysts in the SOC to sort of focus really on the key part and not just do this reactive manual work. So, yeah, I would say SOC automation and orchestration is one of my favorites. There's been a big acquisition recently in that space. And there are interesting competitors as well. So that's my long answer, sorry.
Something to add? Ba, holaxe ez baldin bada, besterik ez badago, agurtu behar dugun ezkero, utziko diogu audientziatik parte hartu duen pertsona bati azken puntua jartzen, asko gustatu zaidalako, oraintxe galderen honetan esan diguna. Vamos a dejarle que le ponga el último broche a este coloquio antes de despedir a nuestros invitados, porque dice, uno de los mejores consejos que le doy a todos mis clientes es el sentido común. En ciberseguridad mejoraríamos mucho con el sentido común. En la vida en general, diría yo también, pero creo que también en este campo. Eskerrik asko, parte hartu duen pertsonari, bere ekarpen honekin, eta mila esker, thank you very much for your coming and for sharing your thoughts and for being here with us. Eskerrik asko, bueno, gurekin izan zaretelako, eta asko, buru argitu, eta bidea erakutsi diguzuelako, bakoitzak bere bidetik, elkarrekin egiten ari garen, bide honetan aurrera egiteko. Txalo egingo diegu, mesedez. Eskerrik asko. Eta honen bestez atxeden hartuko dugu, iruitzen baldin bazaizue, vamos a hacer un receso para recargarnos otra vez de energía y estar de vuelta a las 3, exacto, a ver si voy a colarme y voy a meter la pata en esto. A las 3 de la tarde nos vemos de nuevo y vamos a tener muchísimo más contenido sobre el que seguir trabajando. Beraz, orain etentxoa egingo dugu, bazkaltzeko aukera horri izango duzue, baita ere, enpresekin eta harremanak istekoak, agenda istekoak, meeting point delako horietan topatzeko, iruretan hementxe bueltan izango gara. Honegin.